Was more of a conceptual introduction to the topic of electricity and magnetism. This week we'll be diving more into the mathematics of why these charges attract or repel each other. But first, I just want to take a quick second for a little bit of housekeeping. We'll be continuing with the same overall process of last week in that you'll have kind of a packet guided worksheet to complete. But remember my two keywords for this period, communication and flexibility. So for the flexibility part, we will be modifying the assignment from week to week until it gets a little smoother, okay? So this week, the packet will follow along through this video as I go through some guided explanations. And then for the communication aspect, you all have been doing so wonderfully for that. Don't worry if you think that you're bothering me sending an email. You're not, I promise. I'm actually really I'm really happy that you all have been emailing me, because it shows that you're still learning, you're still here, which is great. And then for reaching out, I'm really grateful that some of you did complete that weekly check-in. Not just for my sake, so that I can kind of see how you're doing, but also so that you can check in with yourself. And I actually do read what you say. Even on the syllabus submission, I do read it, and I take your suggestions. I think about them. When you share good stuff about what's going on, I listen and I care, and I'm grateful that you share that with me, so thank you. One last thing before we dive into the actual physics content is your geckos were amazing. I know that last week was stressful for you. Like, I understand that it was, but from my end as your teacher, it was also kind of stressful. It's a new format. And I worry about y'all, but your geckos made me really happy. Thank you for that. And also, a lot of you named them Phil. This week, we will be continuing our conversation on charge. Oh, I just realized there's a little bit of glare. This says charge part two. So we will be continuing with this. But again, we're going to put more of an analytical component to it, a more mathematic calculation side. Okay, at this point, you will probably want to get out some notebook paper, calculator, pen or pencil, and basically just get yourself ready, get yourself in a comfortable work spot to go through this material and the work packet. First, I want to give you a what I think is a pretty darn cool demo. It ties together a bunch of different things we've been talking about, and also ties it into this new topic.
Hello friends, welcome to our next weekly module, and the lesson for this week will be on charge part two, and we are still in the unit of electricity and magnetism. As you can see, I will be using a document camera to walk through these major concepts. As always, feel free to email me if you have questions, and additionally, I will always have weekly office hours. I've switched them up a little. They will now be Wednesdays and Fridays from 3 to 4 p.m. And I don't have the Zoom ID off the top of my head, but I did send it to you in an email. It is also under the topics and the class topics. And also, feel free to email me if you can't find it anywhere. I'd rather you email than not know. Okay? Let's get started. The last week, we looked at charges more qualitatively. So we know that like charges will repel and opposite charges will attract. You know this just from your everyday experiences in you know, daily life, using like fridge magnets, for example. And so last week we looked at this qualitatively. So let's look at this quantitatively. In order to actually get there to the actual mathematics of this, I want to take a little step back and look at the broader historical context of charge. I want to look at specifically this guy, Charles Augustin de Coulomb, and the experimental method he used to really helped revolutionize a lot of this field. So he used this instrument. It's called a torsion balance instrument. It's not like these scientists are just, you know, reaching into a hat and getting magical information out. They are actually conducted experimental research and discovered some answers. So, Coulomb. In 1785, this guy published his work, which is now known as Coulomb's Law. He got it named after himself because that's what you can do when you discover stuff. So hopefully y'all are out there discovering things later, getting things named after yourselves. What he was interested in was how to predict the force of attraction or repulsion between two charges. So again, we're starting to quantitatively describe what's going on between two charges. In his case, again, he used this. Oh, come on. Hold tight. Let me figure this out. Okay. He used this instrument, this torsion balance instrument, and he looked at how distance related to the magnitude of a charge. This is what his law looks at. You already know kind of the gist of how this works. So let me give you a hypothetical scenario, okay? This is the Earth. You are standing at one pole of the Earth with a magnet. Your friend, oh, can I draw upside down? Boop, boop, boop. Yes, haha. Is standing at the other end of the Earth with a magnet. Pretend they're just simple fridge magnets, right? You already know that these two magnets are not just gonna come together given the long distance between you and your friend, right? But let's say you're standing next to each other with those magnets, right? So we have a longer distance in this scenario. and we have a shorter distance in this scenario. So if I asked you, in which scenario, the Earth distance or the shorter distance, is it more likely for these magnets to be just attracted to each other, for you and your friend to be near each other and have the magnets come together, right? Oh, I did not do that under the camera. Together, right? You already know that that shorter distance is much more likely. Okay. So what Coulomb did was he thought of this concept. He thought of relationship, there we go, the mathematical relationship between this distance and the charge, right? Let us consider a simple scenario. Let's say we have charge number one here, in which I'm going to use the letter Q for charge, okay? So Q is charge, Q1. And we have some charge, Q2, a distance away. So I will say that this distance is the variable R. So far we're looking at Q's for charge and R's for distance. What Coulomb's law states is that the force, the magnitude of the force between two charges equals, I'll use this color, between Q1 and Q2 is directly proportional, Q1, Q2, to their product. However, think of that Earth example where your friend's on the opposite end versus if you're in your kitchen. This force is inversely proportional to the distance squared. Okay? Again, intuitively, you already know this. You know that the stronger the magnet, the more it's going to pull towards other magnetic things, right? So the bigger the Q, the bigger the force. But the farther away you go, the less you feel it, right? But in this case, it's distance R squared, okay? We're going to include one other term in here, and you can kind of think of this like a fudge factor, okay? This other term, let me use a different color, there we go. This other term we call K. K is a proportionality constant, and again, that's kind of like a fudge factor, like we have to include it in here to kind of get the numbers to work out right, but it's still valid. And again, these are our charges, and this is our distance between charges. As a side note, if you're interested in understanding why this proportionality constant has these kind of weird looking units, send me an email or message me on Slack, whatever you prefer. I'm glad to go over it. It's not really in the scope of this class right now, okay? But if you're interested, ask me. I do want to point out what the Coulomb unit really is. So we see that we're using it in this K value. So what is a Coulomb? A Coulomb is the official unit for charge. So this is our first example problem, and this directly involves using Coulomb's law. In this, we are told to determine the magnitude of the electrical force between two balloons that have charges of positive 3.5 times 10 to the minus 8 Coulomb and minus 2.9 times 10 to the minus 8 Coulombs. They're separated by a distance of 0.65 meters. First off, make sure your units are in the correct form you want. So yes, we do want meters. Yes, we do want Coulombs. And the other thing I want to note is that this problem asks for the magnitude of the electrical force. So your answer should be the absolute value of that force, okay? So let's move on to this. Let's actually draw a picture first. So we have balloon number one. Let me do a different color. We have balloon number one separated by a distance to balloon number two. Balloon number one is a positive 3.5, and balloon two is a negative 2.9. They are separated by 0.65 meters. This is a standard kind of plug and chug problem. We know that Coulomb's law states that the force is equal to that constant K times our charges over the square of the distance. So I'm just going to rewrite all that. So we have 8.99 times 10 to the minus, to, oops, sorry, times 10 to the positive 9 Newton per second over Coulombs. Then we have the plus 3.5 times 10 to the minus 8 times minus 2.9 times 10 to the minus 8 Coulomb. All of that is over our 0.65 meters squared. When I plug that into my calculator, so I have 8.99 to the 9 times positive 3.5 to the minus 8 times negative 2.9 to the minus 8 divided by 0.65 squared. Yep, there we go. And so you see that in this I get a negative answer, but again I asked for the magnitude of the force. So we're going to take the absolute value of this. So that would be the force. So the absolute value of the force is 2.16 times 10 to the minus 5. What do you think I should use for my unit here? We're looking at force. What unit did we use for previous problems involving force? What should be going off in your head is that we use the Newton. So this force is equal to 2.16 times 10 to the minus 5 Newtons. I want to follow that up with one additional question. And that is this force attractive or repulsive? You actually don't need to do any calculations to figure this out. Remember, we said that balloon number one had a positive charge, and that balloon number two had a negative charge. So remember that phrase, opposites attract, likes repel. So you should be able to say that this force is attractive between the two balloons. Again, good standard plug and chug question. You can hear my husband and my dog coming in the background and they're flapping their ears. So yeah, let's move on to the next. This is our second example problem. Again, it's a plug and chug, but I just want to show you how to use Coulomb's law. So we have a balloon of a certain charge, and it's being held 0.7 meters away from a balloon with the same charge. So both balloons have a charge of 4 times 10 to the minus 6 Coulombs. Calculate the magnitude of the electrical force between them, and is it attractive or repulsive? Well, actually, we can answer this attractive or repulsive question already. We know that we're working with balloon 1 And it's got a positive charge, right? Because there's an imaginary little plus sign in front of this. Balloon 2 is also positive. So we know that these will be, hopefully you're saying it in your head, they will be repulsive. Remember, try to put like charges together, they try to go the opposite way. So we know it's repulsive. Let's set up our Coulomb's law equation. So we have force equals, so magnitude again, so we're taking the absolute value, is that constant K times Q1 times Q2 over the square of the distance. So I'm gonna plug those numbers in. 10^9 meter squared, Coulomb squared, plus 4.0 times 10^-6 Coulombs. So to save some space, I'm just gonna say squared here, because again, it's just charge 1 times charge 2. All of that over 0.7 meters. Oof, I can write. Oof, let me rewrite that. 0.7 meters squared. So, I won't plug that into my calculator to show you. You can do that for yourself, but our resulting magnitude of the force is 0.29 newtons. Okay, that's example 2. You might be wondering, what is a common answer to get in terms of the magnitude of a charge? So, magnitude of charge. In previous lessons, back when we were in the classroom, we looked at common power ratings, right? And that was to give you a sense of direction for, you know, if you got a power of 9 trillion watts, you might want to go check your math. So I want to give you that same sense of direction for estimating the magnitude of a charge. For example, in the previous problem we looked at, number 2, we found that the magnitude of the force was 0.29 newtons. And you might be asking yourself, okay, so is that like a relevant number? What does that mean? To explain that, we have to think about charge. I will give you what is the charge of an electron. This is an experimentally derived number. This is like the charge of an electron is the charge of an electron, okay? That number is 1.6 times 10 to the minus 19 Coulombs. Look at that, to the minus 19, okay? That's one electron. That is a tiny little number. Let's now address how many Coulombs are in a, let's say, in a standard static electricity interaction. This is also experimentally derived. People can actually measure this. And what was found was that most of the time in these kind of daily, you know, interactions that we actually come into contact with, this is on the order of microcoulombs. So remember, that symbol, micro, is 1 times 10 to the minus 6. So this is 1 times 10 to the minus 6. Coulombs for like just standard, you know, you shocked yourself when you, you know, rubbed your feet or whatever, you know, you rubbed a balloon on your cat and now your cat's staticky and electrocuted you, right? If that's what you're, oh, please don't do that to your cat. This is a standard value. Okay. What I want to look at next is how many electrons are actually in this number. Because remember, when we think about electronics, like, you know, your, like, your phone or a TV or anything like that, we're dealing with the flow of charge. So let's see how many electrons are actually involved in those processes. So let's look into that. Let's say we're working with an everyday value of, you know, static electricity of about 30 microcoulombs. We have this negative in front because we're working with electrons, and electrons are negatively charged. And we're given that the charge of one electron is negative 1.6 times 10 to the minus 19 coulombs. In the previous writing, I told you that this was 1.6. I just gave you the magnitude, okay? That negative sign just tells us that we're working with a negative charge. I actually want you to try figuring this out on your own first. If you're not really sure where to start, I want to bring your attention back to how you converted different values in your chemistry class. So remember, if you had... that's my dog barking. Hold on. Treats are a surefire way to get your dog to be quiet. Okay, yes, yes, okay, I fed you. Yes, yes, go away, go away, go away, unless you can do these problems for me. Go away. Okay. Back to physics. Think about how you converted things in chemistry class. So if you started with one unit, you used a conversion factor to change it, right? So I'm going to give you a second to try this on your own. You may want to pause the video. Okay, I'll give you a second. Did you get your answer was approximately 1.9 times 10 to the 14 electrons? That's a lot of electrons. So let's go back through this process. So we have negative 30.0 microcoulombs, which I'm going to rewrite as negative 30 times 10 to the minus 6 coulombs times my conversion factor. So I know that one electron has a charge of negative 1.6 times 10 to the minus 19 coulombs. Okay? When I do this math, so that's negative 30, E minus 6 divided by 1.6, E minus 19. Yep, I get approximately 1.9 times 10 to the 14 electrons, right? That's a lot. That's actually why when we think of electronics, when we think of how that charge flows, that's a lot of electrons flowing at once, so we get that cumulative effect. So just cool side note about some technology. Okay, let's move on to the next idea. At this time, please take a break to complete numbers 1 through 4 in the assignment packet. These directly deal with analyzing and interpreting Coulomb's law, which I have listed here, and you may want to pause and write this down. Also, you may want to pause and go take a stretch break, go get some water if you haven't had water yet. So come back to this video when you've completed 1 through 4. Welcome back. So I'm going to assume that you were able to complete numbers 1 through 4. If you had trouble, feel free to reach out to email me, and I encourage you to come to office hours as well. So the next section we're going to cover kind of is a blast from the past from what you've learned in physics class. Oh, that all rhymed. So you, I'm going to assume that you all looked at Newton's law of gravitation. I'm going to assume that you all covered this. Hopefully you remember it. But this is actually really interesting because it has a connection to what we're learning now. If you remember, Newton's law of gravitation said that the force of gravity between two objects is equal to the product of the masses over the square of their distance, and we have a proportionality factor here called g. Doesn't this look oddly similar to something we just covered? The force, the electrostatic, the electric force between two charges is equal to k times q1 times q2 over the distance squared. These have an oddly familiar and similar form, right? Let's look at this. Let's think about how strong the force of gravity is and this electric force, right? In terms of everyday stuff. First, let's make a quantitative comparison. Specifically, we are going to look at those proportionality constants. By that, I mean we will look at K from Coulomb's law versus the gravitational constant, G, and Newton's law of gravitation, yeah? Let's look at their magnitudes. So, K. We know that K is equal to 8.99 times 10 to the 9, and we won't look at the units right now. We're just looking at the magnitude of these numbers, okay? We also know that G is 6.67 times 10 to the minus 11. Okay, let's look at that. 10 to the 9 versus 10 to the minus 11. In terms of strength, the K constant, K in Coulomb's law, is about 20 times the strength of the gravitational constant. And this intuitively should start to make sense. Let's take these numbers and let's think about this qualitatively. Qualitative comparison. Okay. Let's compare. Let's say you walk into your kitchen, and in your kitchen, you've got a fridge, right? And on that fridge, you have a magnet. Which force is stronger, gravity or the electric force in holding this magnet? What would it look like if gravity was stronger? What would happen to this magnet? Wouldn't that magnet be like pulled to the floor, right? If gravity went out? But the electric force wins out because that magnet is still stuck to your fridge, right? And it's not like when you are out and about walking, keeping your 6 foot social distancing minimum, it's not like you and that person 6 feet away, it's not like gravity doesn't suddenly just pull you two together, right? But when you're holding two magnets together, that electrical force wins out. So, when we think about gravity, the gravitational force versus the electric force, we see that nature keeps this pattern. Again, mathematically, we see these similarities. But in terms of strength, we can think about how these forces differ and why that's important in our daily lives, that you know, I'm walking down the street and a car comes by and I'm not just pulled into its gravitational field, right? That would be terrible. We can think about how we can use the electric force in our daily lives versus how the gravitational force affects us. So if you could, now take a look at number five on your packet. Let me double check that. Yes, number five on your packet. Please complete that before moving on to the next section. Again, if you need to, take a break. Go maybe take a little walk, you know, drink some water. Do some yoga, play with a dog or cat. This doesn't have to be completed all at once. Before we move on to the online lab portion of your assignment for this week, I want to briefly introduce the next topic in this unit, okay? So we've talked about charge. Now we are going to introduce the idea of the electrical field. And I want to do that by showing you a little demo after this, which I think is pretty neat. But what this boils down to is that any charged object has an electrical or electric field. You might have seen these if you've like flipped through your physics textbook, for example. You might see two charges and you see lines, right? You see lines coming back and forth from these charge objects. These lines describe the field. And this field is important in understanding how that force between charges, changes across distance. And what you'll see in this lab is actually that you'll see how the charge is affected by distance. And I just want to point out that the lines we actually draw, so these arrowheads, the actual arrowheads themselves, the lines themselves don't exist, okay? It's not like if you put this under a microscope, if you put a charge under a microscope, you would physically see, like, painted lines between them. No, we as people, this is how we help quantify and describe the situation, okay? So these lines are technically imaginary, but they are actually describing the physical phenomena between these charges, okay? And we use these, and so the force fields are important in application. So this is actually directly, let me spell it, applications. So these fields are actually what we use in later calculations to figure out how electronics work and how a magnet would work in a certain scenario. So again, we're starting with these smaller ideas. So we've looked at charge. We've looked at the force of the charge. And now we are going to the force fields of the charge. Before you go on to the online lab, which is linked in the assignment, check out actually this demo. This is actually pretty fun, okay? Hold tight. Welcome to the electric field demo. So the materials I have for this are an acrylic box to keep everything... Hold on. Okay, maybe that woke you up from my dog howling. Anywho, so I have this acrylic container to actually keep everything inside, and you'll see why. I also have these bar magnets. I have four of these, okay? These are very, very strong magnets. Like, when I'm holding this, it's very, it, like, They are strong, okay? Very strong magnets. Okay. Next up, we have, where'd it go? We have iron filings. Hold on one second. My dog is like... Okay. Okay, so we have iron filings. And I love how this was shipped to me in a... It looks like a spice shaker. Pretty neat. Do not sprinkle these on your food. These are not iron supplements. What I'm going to do is I'm actually going to put on some gloves because I don't feel like having iron filings underneath my fingernails. What I'm going to do, so gloves. Also, side note, if any of you have been using gloves during this quarantine period, make sure you're not touching your face with your gloves because that defeats the purpose. I'm going to stick two of these bar, actually I'm going to start out with one. One bar magnet underneath this acrylic container. Okay, I'm doing that so that the iron filings don't just get stuck permanently to the magnet because they're that strong of magnets. Okay, so ta-da, we have one bar magnet underneath this acrylic container. I'm next going to take my iron filings and I'm going to gently sprinkle, I guess the shaker was useful, onto the acrylic. And before I do that, take a second and, I'm sorry, my dog is drinking water in the background. Hold on. Willow, can you please stop? Willow, thank you. Thank you. Okay. Before I do this, think about what it might look like. So I gave kind of a cartoon illustration previously. Think about it, okay? Okay. Let's see. You can start to see that we have these rings forming around the poles, right? And we can see that the iron filings are very attracted to the ends, to where the magnets are strongest for their poles, right? Let's continue this. Ooh, do you see that? We continue to have these rings. So we can say north, south, positive, negative. It's just nomenclature. So we can see that's very attracted to each pole. But look at what's happening between the northern and southern poles. You see these other concentric rings, right? Let's add a little more. Maybe we can get it to show up even more. Look at that. We see these discrete patterns, right? And that's very similar to what I drew on the last page. Let's bump this up to two magnets. Now I have two bar magnets underneath the acrylic. Let's start sprinkling. Isn't that cool? You can still see that each of the poles on each of the magnets is attracting a lot of the filings. Very, very strong there, that force, right? You can see these concentric rings forming though. Ooh, and look at this. Look at when these two magnets are closer to each other. You can start to see those fields. Like up here, you see them kind of going like left to right, but then here it's up and up to down, and then left to right, up to down. That's pretty darn neat. These fields describe a lot of these magnets' interactions. Let's bump this up to four. I now have one, two, three, four bar magnets underneath the acrylic. Let's look at this. So before I do this, pause for a second and think about what you think these fields will look like, okay? Think about it. Now let's test it. Again, we can see that those filings are really going for the poles. Look at that. Isn't that neat? We are directly observing the strength of electric fields and electric forces. I mean, I'm just sprinkling some iron shavings and we can see these different forces among the four magnets forming these cool patterns. So what you're going to do in this online lab is right now we're focusing on analyzing just one charge, okay? I want you to look at how these forces and fields are affected by the different variables in that equation. So go ahead, move on to the online lab. And again, if you have questions, reach out, come to office hours, email me. But isn't this neat? Okay, I have to clean this now. Side note for gloves, in case any of you all have been using gloves or have family members using gloves, I've seen a lot of people not practicing correct glove usage, like again, touching their faces, which, why are you wearing gloves? So, I have gloves on right now. How do you take these off without rubbing your hands with the outside of the gloves? Because again, that completely defeats the purpose. What you want to do is peel off one glove by not touching the inside with the other glove. Peel that off. See, it's all kind of sweaty. It's okay. That's what happens. What I do is I use my thumb to hook under the other glove, okay? Again, if you're using gloves, please don't touch your face. Please, you know, make sure you take them off in a proper fashion so that you're not defeating the purpose, so that you're staying safe. Okay, friends, that is it for this week's new material. If you have any questions, please, please, please reach out. Email me, message me. If you can't make it to the normal office hours, which are on Wednesdays and Fridays from 3 to 4 p.m., we can set up additional Zoom times. I'm here to help you learn. And also, I hope that you all are doing okay. I hope that between assignments that you're going for a walk, that you're maybe taking a few minutes to breathe, you know, that you're drinking some water, that you're taking care of yourselves. Additionally, I think that I'm going to make it a thing where Friday nights I stream me playing Pokemon, and I would love for you all to join me. I really need help naming my Pokemon. I'm really bad at that. So most of the time my husband just names them, and then they're like really bad names. So, like, dumb names. So, please help me name my Pokemon. Okay. Have a good rest of the week. Take care of yourselves. Bye.